Hello, I'm Jeremy from AltRider, and we're going to go over the installation for the Tuareg 660 lowering or fully adjustable link. Gives you two positions of rise and two positions of lower. Once this thing's installed, actually making adjustments thereafter is really easy. We highly encourage you guys to use those easy adjustments as you progress through both your training and your evolution or growing in riding, but also then when the different trips, right? So if you know for the next 3 months you're going to be riding in city and you want lots of confidence, fine, put it in the lowest position. But then if you know you're going on that ADV weekend, go ahead and consider if you need more ground clearance for the terrain or if you're carrying more gear. Let's go over what's included in your kit. So you'll receive the actual link, so a beautiful billet link. There's that indicator for you for the different inserts. And then already we've pressed the factory equivalent needle bearings that are sealed for you. So gorgeous piece. There's the three bolts that'll actually carry and mount your UHMW linkage guard, which is a gorgeous piece. This is an earlier prototype. It'll actually have more return, gives you full protection even when you're going backwards. So a lot of linkage guards are just cold formed versus billet. This thing's actually been machined out of a solid block. And what that gets you is if you ever need to pull backwards over an obstacle that you're stuck on, it doesn't tear the piece off. It actually ramps up and carries it back over the obstacle that you're stuck on. Then you have the three flatheads that hold your linkage guard. And then here are the two inserts, and they're very easily labeled, so it's very easy to understand and make the adjustments as you see fit or as you want to do. So there's your two inserts. The tools required to do the install, you'll need a lift or some bucket or some block stack to get the bike off the ground, which will make it really easy to be then pulling the link out and then changing the two pivot bolts. Then, while we're in there, guys, this is a great time to clean everything up and just re-grease those pivot bolts. So some grease, a rag. Then I need a number four Allen. I've got it on a quarter inch driver. You need a 13 millimeter wrench or socket equivalent and a 15 millimeter wrench or socket equivalent. These are for the pivot bolts. And if you purchase from AltRider, you'll receive a resealable bottle of Loctite. This is great, guys, after you do your installation. Highly encourage you to throw that resealable bottle into your trail bag. That way, when you're doing repairs on the side of the trail, you've got Loctite readily available. This is a pretty easy installation. Probably the hardest thing is finding a jack. If you don't have a jack, finding a way to just get the bike where I have just the rear wheel off the ground to allow me to make this swap. Once we've got the rear wheel in the air, all I've got to do is go ahead and pull those pivot bolts off. I'm going to pull the rear one first, then the front one. The bolt head is a 13, the nut is a 15. Again, 15 millimeters is my nut, the 13 is my bolt, and there's usually enough friction on this setup with the wheel hanging there that it's going to have enough friction to hold this. So I'm going to just get that nut loose and turn it until that bolt turns. And actually, because the wheel's on there, I have enough friction and it will hold that bolt. Because of that friction, now it's really hard to push that bolt out. So a tip is I just get my toe underneath it here. I don't need to lift it all the way up. I just need to take a little bit of the load off, and then I'm going to be able to push that bolt out because I've taken that load off. You know, now it's free falling, so I just get my foot out of there. And now our front pivot bolt won't have any issue because there's going to be no load on there. Of course, we're reusing those pivot bolts. We'll clean those up and grease them. Same principles, guys, but now I'm definitely going to need to be able to hold that other side as that bolt's going to turn on me here shortly. And so I'll come around. As we said, it's a 13 for the head. And so I get the 13 on there, and then I can just finish taking this nylock off of the pivot bolt. And then once I've walked that all the way out, walk the bolt out, and then your pivot. If you have your swing arm too far down, you may need to bring it up to get that the lowering link to clear the bell crank. So you see that, guys, I just lifted that up so that came out. Go ahead and just get the linkage guard installed. So I'm gonna go ahead and do two drops on my flatheads and go ahead and get these started into my lowering link. And then go ahead and torque down your flatheads. Take the OEM bushing out of my lowering link. So this is that front bushing. This one's actually in great condition, nice and clean. But take a moment, guys. Let's go ahead and clean this and look for any oxidation. If there is, that's a time to wire wheel or even use a little bit of emery cloth. This guy's gorgeous. Our bearings come already pre-greased. There's a cage in there holding them all in place. You don't need to worry about the needles, but I'm gonna just put a film of grease along the outside. Don't need to worry about that inner diameter because we're gonna grease the pivot bolts. Okay, so I've got a nice little bed of grease there. And this guy will just pop right in there and just set it in the center. Before we get down to the bottom of the bike, I'm gonna take a moment. These are nice and clean. Again, though, it's a chance to look for any oxidation, get these all cleaned up. And then I just like to keep a little bit of grease, a little film of grease on the pivot bolts. These are functioning similar to the axle bolts on the front rear wheel. Of course, there are two differing lengths. You can see that the long one is for the rear and the shorter one's gonna go in the front. I want to set the bike in the tallest position for the first setup. So I'm going to find that 20, one dot, that's the first bolt hole. So I'm gonna be going into that first bolt hole. I'm configuring, so single dot, single dot, single dot. And now let's go down there to install with our pre-greased OEM bolts. Just like when we came off, you're gonna need to lift the linkage. If you don't have a helper, I just go ahead and lift the free floating swing arm, see that? And I got it on my boot, and I grab my shorter bolt, which the shorter bolt is that front one. Now I can just slide that up and in there, and then I come around, and I'm gonna align the bolt hole to that frame mount, and get it to pass through the bushing. I've dropped my insert. I know I wanted to be one dot forward. And then I wanted to be on the front dot for the tallest position. And then I catch that position, sweet. Okay, so now I'm in that tallest position. I go ahead and just get my nut started on the other side. And remember, it was a 13 for the bolt head and a 15 for the rear nut, and we'll go ahead and get those tightened down. All right, and same thing on the rear. These Nylocks don't need any Loctite. Okay, torque that down to spec. Now we're at the tallest position. Actually, I'm quite excited about this position. So this is giving us 20 millimeters taller than the OEM, and you can tell, wow, this is definitely where I want my adjustable kickstand, because it is a heave to get it up onto a neutral or a balance. So here's the bike. Again, at 5'10", you'll see where I'm at. So now I feel like I'm on a dirt bike. I'm comfortable, as I'm comfortable on dirt bikes, but I am just on my toes, by all means. But boy, do I have a lot of ground clearance, and it would feel a lot more comfortable if I was riding very aggressively off-road. So again, even if you're not an aggressive rider, I'd really encourage you to try this, as it only takes us 4 minutes, right? We just unload that rear wheel and then do that pivot change. So again, here I am in the lowest position of the seat, tallest height, 20 millimeters over OEM. Suspension is you can get your master's in suspension, but let's talk about some of the basics, because if we're gonna be adjusting either by rising the rear or lowering the rear, we wanna make sure that we're, to the best of our abilities, addressing the front of the bike. Keep in mind, guys, that some people are making adjustments just to the front to make their bike more balanced right from the beginning. So let's talk about what your bike is doing if it's biased upward or biased backward. And so that way you can start and already know which direction you're gonna wanna go. It's not like this bike is balanced for you. Every person who sits back here weighs something different, and what they're carrying weighs something different. So that's changing how that bike's gonna ride and then the type of riding they're doing, whether it's high speed highway commuting versus off-road riding, is gonna change what they're wanting. So let's just do some real high level basics so you understand what you're coming into. Ultimately, guys, if the forks are down and the front is lifted, the rear is back, right? Just think of this as a choppered effect. The benefit to that is you have a very stable front end at high speed. The drawback is that the steering will be sluggish or slow. So tight maneuvers are gonna be a bit sluggish and slow. Very stable at high speed, both off-road and on-road. Almost never gonna have a speed wobble. This bike's very good, unlike the T7, which you'll start to experience that speed wobble around 90 miles an hour. Now, Let's go the opposite. If the tail is high, they call this stink bug versus chopper. Stink bug, tail's high, the fork tubes are sucked way up, and it's biased downward. So now I'm gonna have really aggressive steering, very, very aggressive, so it's gonna turn quickly, both off-road or in tight road sections. And the drawback is now I've lost that stability, that high-speed stability. You're almost asking for a speed wobble in those sort of situations if you've got the forks sucked up that much in your stink bug. Okay, guys? So that's exaggerated, but you want to pay attention to how is yours behaving, and that way you know out of the gate, do you want to stay neutral, or is your bike already biased a little bit? Now that we've adjusted the rear, let's start with the beginning, which is we've risen the bike as much as we can. And so because of how the bikes are PDI'd, which is post-delivery inspection, it might be a kid making 12 bucks who opens the pallet and just puts your bike together. Doesn't really know where to set these fork tubes, but you should at PDI have anywhere from 5 to 10 millimeters, and it's from this first chamfer. Don't ever clamp down on the cap. Don't go all the way to the bottom because there's no clamping material there. Go right to that first chamfer. And we'll show you how to do this, and that's gonna bring the front back up to match the tallest rise in the rear. So when you do that rise of 20 millimeters, you wanna shoot for 50% of that. So go ahead and drop the fork tubes 5 to 10 millimeters to start to balance it out, and then go feel it, guys. This isn't a science. You wanna go by feel. How does that feel for you? Raised 20 millimeters. Raised 6 millimeters, and then back to OEM, and then my next lowering is 20 millimeters, so I'd go to 10. There's my 19, it gets to 10 millimeters of, I'm rising it, which is lowering the bike, and then my next one is 32, so I'd want to go to 15, and that takes me to this guy plus. So you need a 6 millimeter Allen key to loosen the fork trees, and all you've got to do is loosen, you don't need to remove them, and you got to remove, loosen both sides. It of course helps to have this up on a stand, but it's absolutely not necessary, but it helps to have it up on a stand so that they're not already under pressure and going to come shooting up at you. So we can just go ahead and loosen these, and you have to be very careful that you don't ever tighten these too much because you could damage or at a minimum cause stiction, meaning you, these are hollow tube aluminum, and so these are not the normal tightening specs for these Allen screws. You want to just tighten them to what the factory says so you don't create any additional friction on your front forks and the suspension is able to function flawlessly. So now I'm gonna adjust my other side, but when we make any adjustments to the fork, we wanna be very methodical so that we end up with a parallel axle to the ground, that we don't end up cocking the fork tubes. And you can go ahead and twist these all day. They pivot on the stanchion, so it's not like you're gonna twist the axle. And so there, you can see that I got it right to the chamfer, and there's my position, both sides, for the risen position. And now, we don't need to demonstrate it, but the second rise position is a 6 millimeter rise, and that would just really be a very subtle 3 millimeters. We would probably go ahead and, instead of going that full 10 millimeter drop, we're gonna probably go something like 3 millimeters reduction. But now let's talk about if we were to have lowered the bike 19 or 32 millimeters. If we lower the bike 19 millimeters, I'm gonna wanna target something like an 8 to 10 millimeter rise. So I'm gonna bring my fork tubes up, and they may take a little bit of work, and you could twist them back and forth and walk them up so that they don't bind. So I walk up each one, and again, you can keep twisting. You can see in the machine marks where the flat is. So I'll actually even drop this tube down so you get to see that. So just never exceed that, which is the end of where it goes flat and it's beginning to taper or enlarge, and that clamp can no longer grab correctly because the material is starting to taper away. So just don't ever go beyond that, which is gonna be way more than any lowering situation you would ever need. Once you get that and you know you're exactly calibrated, meaning I want to be exactly equal on both sides. I'm gonna go ahead and tighten, but you want to do this sequentially to the torque spec. So I go ahead and snug that one up, but I don't actually take it to the torque spec. And then I'm gonna go ahead and do maybe quarter returns until I get to the actual click. And then I come up here, quarter turn to the click. And that way it ensures both end up at that same torque load by doing it sequentially, not all at once. So just go ahead and snug one, then rock it to the next one. And it's because they're slowly clamping down. If you try to torque one to the spec and you go to the next one, you'll just continually keep clamping greater and greater. So just slowly walk into it, alternating between the two bolts on the clamp. Check to make sure nothing moved. Now I can tighten up this side. Same concept, guys. Just snug one side and then walk back and forth between the clamping bolts to get up to the force you need. As always, thanks again for supporting AltRider, an American-based company with real riders. The actual engineers are here. We pride ourselves in the customer service that we're able to answer the questions, get you the support that you need, and really proud about the fact that we're always innovating. So, pretty simple product, pull rods, but I think executed elegantly, that gives you the innovation of those incremental adjustments that are very simple to do and great for a training aid to take you into the advanced end or allow you to continue to progress your riding skills. Again, everybody, thanks so much. And if you've got any questions, please reach out to us at AltRider.